All right. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, this is actually lesson number 136 and actually part 5 in a series focusing in on the issue of body life. And we're in a section here in 1 Corinthians chapter 12 where I kind of wanted to spend some time looking at the doctrine of, quote, body life. I'm borrowing an expression that was coined back in the 70s, actually. But when we look at the relationship that exists between the members of the church, the body of Christ, there are many passages that instruct the body of Christ in the proper maintenance of those relationships, the interrelatedness of the body, all right? So we're in 1 Corinthians chapter 12. I'm not going to read the entire section, but as a reminder, notice at verse 12, "For as the body is one and hath many members, and all the members of that one body, being many, are one body, so also is Christ." Notice verse 14, "For the body is not one member, but many." Drop down to verse 27, "Now ye are the body of Christ, and members in particular." So obviously from verses 12 through verse 27, this is a hefty section addressing the life that is to be enjoyed because we're living, loving, eternal members of this one body, the church, the body of Christ. So we've been looking at the issue of being compacted and joined together. You recall in the book of Ephesians where we learn about being compacted, and that the idea there is there shouldn't be any space between us. We want to eliminate the space and the distance and the alienation. So we have a responsibility to be joined together. Paul calls it in the book of Colossians, being knit together in love, okay? Well, what we're looking at are a number of passages. We're not going to examine each and every one, but we're looking at a number of passages that are called one anothering. There are these passages where the Apostle Paul exhorts the church, the body of Christ, to one another, all the members of the body of Christ. That's why we're now part five. We're going to pick it up here and focus on love. But by the way, if you do not have the little handout that was available when we started the series on body life, they're all up here. We'll leave the handouts back on the table there. And help yourself to the handout and follow along, okay? We saw, but let's go quickly. Go to Romans chapter 12, one of the first one-anothering principles, one of the first one-anothering commands. And I'm hesitant to use the word command. Sometimes people misunderstand that. We don't mean a command in a, quote, legalistic sense. But if we use the term exhortation, principle, command, whatever floats your boat, one of the first ones that are found is here in the book of Romans, verse 10. "Be kindly affectioned one to another with brotherly love, in honor, preferring one another." So here we have the first one anothering commands, be kindly affectioned, and then in honor, preferring one another. We looked at some of the issues regarding all of that. We saw, by the way, a passage there in 1 Corinthians chapter 16. We actually started by looking at the exhortation to greet one another. And I wanted to start with the greeting one another because that's, I think, an appropriate time to learn what it means to greet one another. John says, greet one another by name. So there's something real significant about that. We are now going to pick it up, and let's look now at Romans chapter 13, okay? The next, quote, one anothering commands is found here in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, and notice there at verse 8, okay? 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 8. "Owe no man anything but to love one another. For he that loveth another hath fulfilled the law. For this, thou shalt not commit adultery, thou shalt not kill, thou shalt not steal, thou shalt not bear false witness, thou shalt not covet. And if there be any other commandment, it is briefly comprehended in this saying, namely, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. Love worketh no ill to his neighbor, therefore love is the fulfilling of the law. Now, interestingly enough, the section we just read has its context in society. How is it that the believer is to relate to society? There is instruction that will provide the proper order within the civic ranks. Now, it sounds a little odd. Now, we're going to focus on one loving one another as members of the body of Christ, but just be mindful here at verse 8, owe no man anything but to love one another. Our attitude towards those in the world, our attitude towards those in society, this includes unsaved humanity, we owe a debt of love, okay? So just be mindful, but to love one another. Now, when Paul talks about loving those in society, go over to 1 Thessalonians chapter 3 and just note how he exhorts the Thessalonians. 1 Thessalonians chapter 3, and notice there at verse 12. Chapter 3, verse 12. And the Lord make you to increase and abound in love, here we go again, one toward another, and toward all men, even as we do toward you. So you see, obviously, Paul's exhorting the Thessalonians to love one another, and then he adds, and toward all men. The all men is what Romans chapter 13, verse 8 is referring to. Okay, so let's go back quickly to Romans chapter 13. And again, we're going to focus more on the members of the body of Christ loving one another. But let's just certainly don't forget that we do have a debt to society. Our debt to society is to love them. And now we're going to look at some passages. Love is taught. God teaches us how we by nature don't really love. In fact, many of us don't really like society. And when Paul here says to love one another and toward all men, we need to learn how to do that because it does not come naturally. And we'll say some more things about all of that. But just by the way, verse 8, owe no man anything but to love one another, for he that loveth another hath fulfilled the law. And then if you notice there at verse 10, love worketh no ill to his neighbor, therefore love is the fulfilling of the law. Paul is not suggesting that we today revert back to the Mosaic law program. In fact, Paul is not, quote, pro-law. You know what Paul is doing here in this section? He is proving once again that love, which is a product of grace, is far better than the law program. There is no law operating system. There is no law system that can ever achieve what love can ultimately achieve. I say that because there are many in, quote, Christendom, they would assume when Paul talks about fulfilling the law that that's what we're supposed to be doing. We're supposed to live our lives and we're supposed to evaluate our lives and ensure that we are, quote, fulfilling the precepts of the law program. Paul is not even suggesting we do that. The language is pretty obvious. He's saying there's something better than the law. You see, the Mosaic operating system, which, as you know, is a performance management system. We don't need to review all of that. You understand that the law, if thou do, if you don't, there is a system of reward, there's a system of punishment, and so forth. It's a condition-based system of performance. The law says you do good and you earn a reward. But the law also stipulates you fail, then you suffer the consequences, okay? That's the law system. Grace, which produces love, is a far better operating system because it's an unconditional way of relating to people. Listen, I don't have to love society because, quote, the law tells me to do it. I can love society because of who I am in the person of our Lord Jesus Christ. And my Father provides some doctrine that teaches me how to love society as He loves society. And when love, when we understand love, it is an unconditional system where we live out our identity in Christ. So what Paul is doing is actually demonstrating once again that love is a far better, a superior way of relating to people, all right? Not the law, okay? Now, I also want to point something out. Sometimes there's a little bit of discussion. For example, look at the end of verse 9. Look there at the end of verse 9. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. Who's your neighbor? Now, I know there are some people that they I don't know why there's a lot of controversy over, well, okay, I'm supposed to love my neighbor. Who's my neighbor? Interesting. You know that that's a statement that we find back in Luke chapter 10. And before we go there, look at verse 10 again. Love worketh no ill. You see the word ill? That's a contraction of the word evil. By the way, how do you work ill to your neighbor? Again, you have that word neighbor. Okay, we have to identify who is my neighbor. And the exhortation, verse 10, is love worketh no ill. Again, a contraction of the word evil. We don't respond to our neighbor with an evil spirit. And by the way, didn't Paul already in chapter 12 tell us something about evil? He's not talking about evil in a general sense. You know, we think about evil as, of course, rebellion and sin and transgression and so on and so forth. We understand evil is used in that way. When Paul talks about evil in chapter 12, he's talking about something far more specific. Love will never work ill. We're not going to seek to do evil. What kind of evil is Paul talking about? Well, when we go back to chapter 12, notice in verse 9, let love be without dissimulation. In other words, our love has to be a representation of God's love. And that's what we're going to spend time on a little in just a few minutes, right? There is a, and I'm going to use the word divine, there is a higher level of God love that we are called upon to express. Okay, verse 9, let love be without dissimulation. The highest levels of love, and we're gonna define that in just a second. The end of verse 9, abhor that which is, here we go, evil. Cleave to that which is good. Well, again, what specifically is Paul talking about? Drop down to verse 17. Recompense to no man evil for evil. Provide things honest in the sight of all men. Why don't we keep reading? If it be possible, as much as lieth in you, live peaceably with all men. Listen, we don't ever want to be the cause of turmoil and resentment and conflict. Live peaceably. If there is conflict between you and your neighbor, make sure it's your neighbor's fault, not our fault, okay? We live how? Peaceably. Our goal is to coexist, not compromise. You understand that, okay? But if I can't get along with the world, it's going to be their fault, okay? Not my fault. It should never be the fault of the believer. Verse 18, if it be possible, as much as lieth in you, live peaceably with all men. Now Paul's going to talk about evil. Dearly beloved, verse 19, avenge not yourselves, but rather give place unto wrath. For it is written, vengeance is mine. I will repay, saith the Lord. Therefore, if thine enemy hunger, feed him. If he thirst, give him drink. For in so doing, thou shalt heap coals of fire on his head. Be not overcome of evil, but overcome evil with good. Paul in verse 9 talks about a specific type of evil. He repeats it again in verse 17, and he brings it up again in verse 21. The evil that Paul is talking about is retaliation, vengeance. And I know who I am in my flesh. Somebody crosses you. Somebody offends you. Somebody does something wrong to you. What do we instinctively seek to do? I don't get mad. How can we know that? I don't get mad. I get what? That's evil. That is not godly love. Let love be without dissimulation. That is not divine love. Okay, so my point is this. Paul is telling us when we seek retribution, when we desire to retaliate and avenge ourselves because of the wrong and the offense, and even when we know that the offense perpetrated against us is just, it's wrong, that drives you a little more bananas, right? Sometimes people take advantage of it, but when you know it is an absolute unjust way of treating me, you know what God says? You feed them. You give them drink. That's what divine love does, okay? So with that in mind, the specific evil Paul's talking about is don't seek vengeance. Let it go. You know, you don't need to pay anybody back by exacting a pound of flesh. That's what our sin nature wants to do. Godly love says, I'm going to let it go. I'll leave it at Calvary. And God says, don't you worry about it. I will repay. So when we go to chapter 13, the end of verse 9, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. Love worketh no ill. I don't have any ill will, evil intent to attack. So on to his neighbor, therefore love is the fulfilling of the law. Okay, let's define who is, quote, our neighbor. Let's go to Luke chapter 10, okay? Luke chapter 10. A fascinating incident here in Luke chapter 10. There is this lawyer at verse 25, Luke chapter 10, verse 25. And behold, a certain lawyer, a lawyer knows how to argue the case, right? Stood up and tempted him. So obviously his motives aren't very pure, we understand that. Master, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? By the way, what shall I do? See, there's the legalist. You see, he's a lawyer, right? The legalist thinks I have to do something. In Christ, it's already done. That's the difference between the law and grace. The law says do, 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 and grace says done, done, done. Okay? That's why Jesus says with men, it's impossible, but with God. So when it comes to eternal life, you can't do it, but Jesus Christ has already done it. Now, that's kind of a little rabbit trail there. Verse 26, he said unto him, what is written in the law? Why would the Lord ask that? Because this guy's a lawyer. Okay, so what must I do to have eternal life? Okay, what is written in the law? How? Now, by the way, how do you read it? Notice the Lord didn't say, what do you read? Do you see the difference there? You see, the Lord could have said, well, what do you read? And I can spit up the data and the cold, hard, sterile statistics, so on and so forth. The question that Jesus Christ asked is not what do you read, how do you interpret what you're reading? So how readest thou? Verse 27, and he answering said, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart and with all thy soul and with all thy strength and with all thy mind and thy neighbor as thyself. And he said unto him, the Lord Jesus said, answers unto him, thou hast answered right, this do, and thou shalt live. But he, willing to justify himself, said unto Jesus, and who is my neighbor? What? You talk about a legal argument, he's a typical lawyer, right? This is how he understands the law. And love your neighbor as thyself. The Lord says, yep, good job. But there's a problem here. See, evidently, he can't say whether or not he loves what God loves. So now you have by the way, isn't it interesting that lawyers, you know, oftentimes when lawyers meet, and they begin negotiations, one of the first things that they have to do is define words. You know why? Because the way David might define a word might be different than the way I define a word. In fact, you'll learn that when ambassadors, they fly all over the place. I forgot the ambassador, this was years ago, describing whenever there were negotiations with North Korea, there was an advance team that would arrive at North Korea before all the big shots, and they would spend 2 to 3 days. You have the North Koreans and you have the Americans. They would spend a couple of days having to define words. Why? Because it may mean different things, correct? So here's a lawyer. Well, who is a neighbor? Does that mean I'm supposed to love everybody? Am I supposed to love the unlovely? Am I supposed to love the enemies? You see, here's the lawyer to justify himself. Well, maybe there are times and conditions and personalities where I'm not obligated to love them because they fall into a different category, okay? Typical law speak. They're good at all that, right? Verse 29, but he, willing to justify himself, said unto Jesus, and who is my neighbor? Now, remember, this guy's goal is to tempt him, okay? He's tempting the Lord. And so here we go, verse 30. And Jesus answering said, a certain man went down from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell among thieves, which stripped him of his raiment and wounded him and departed, leaving him half dead. Now the guy's from Jerusalem. The odds are he's Jewish, okay? So I take it as this is an Israeli, okay? He's in Jerusalem. So he's heading down to Jericho, and he gets robbed, all right? He gets stripped, he's ripped off, he's left half dead. Verse 31, and by chance there came down a certain priest. Here comes religion. That way, and when he saw him, he passed on the other what? So here you have religion. So I want you to appreciate this. What did religion say? Did the religion, that the priest representing religion, did he view this guy in the ditch as his neighbor? No, he's not my neighbor. So the audacity, he actually passed on the other side, turned a blind eye to the whole thing. Well, here's a guy who supposedly knows the system, a priest. And in his thinking, that lowlife out in the ditch probably had it coming. Probably does it, whatever the excuse was. My point is this. This priest did not view the guy in the ditch as a neighbor. Verse 32, and likewise a what? A Levite. So here we go again. Another member of the nation of Israel, specifically the tribe of Levi, which had a very good reputation. They had a history, okay? Verse 32, and likewise a Levite, when he was at the place, came and looked on him and passed on the other side. The Levite saw the guy in the ditch, not my neighbor. So what did he do? What most of us do when we view the down and outers and so on and so forth. Is that guy my neighbor? I keep thinking about Mr. Rogers. Won't you be my neighbor? Okay. Now look at verse 33. But a certain Samaritan, we're not going to get. Did the Jew have any fondness for the Samaritan? You know, historically, a lot of animosity. It all has to go, it goes all the way back, you know, the division of the kingdom. You had the 10 northern tribes and something, blah, blah, blah. We're not going to get into all of that. But listen, here's a Samaritan who's hated by the ranks of Israel, okay? I just appreciate what's going on here, okay? The Samaritans were inferior in the thinking of the nation of Israel, the Levites, the priests. Verse 33, but a certain Samaritan, as he journeyed, came where he was and saw him. He had compassion on him and went to him and bound up his wounds, pouring in oil and wine, and set him on his own beast and brought him into an inn and took care of him. And on the morrow, when he departed, he took out 2 pence and gave them to the host and said unto him, take care of him, and whatsoever thou spendest more, when I come again, I will repay thee. Now look what the Lord Jesus says, verse 36. Which now of these three thinkest thou was neighbor unto him that fell among the thieves? And he said, he that showed mercy on him. Then said Jesus unto him, go and do thou likewise. Evidently, this guy didn't have a history of doing that. So you're trying to tempt the living word of God? See, the Lord knows why he asked who my neighbor is, because this guy already had a propensity. Probably he already had an encounter where he already is defining who the neighbor is. So the Lord Jesus sets him right and then exhorts him, then you do the same thing, buddy, because I know what's in your heart, okay? Here's my point. You have a Samaritan deemed an enemy of the nation of Israel. And what does he do? He cares for that guy. So we know when the Bible describes thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself, and if we go back again, Romans 13, very quickly, again, the end of verse 9, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. Verse 10, love worketh no ill, again, no evil, to his neighbor. Listen, that's society. We don't get to pick and choose who our neighbor is. Okay? Everyone in society is our neighbor. The end of verse 10, therefore, love is the fulfilling of the law. Love works every time. It achieves what the law fails to do. Okay? So, let's look at the passages. Now, that's society in that context. But we're going to focus on the exhortation to love one another as fellow members of the body of Christ. Let's look at a few passages. Galatians chapter 5. Let's just identify some of the passages. And obviously, I would encourage you to study these individual passages and spend some time in Galatians chapter 5. And notice there, verse 13. Galatians chapter 5, verse 13. For brethren, ye have been called unto liberty, only use not liberty for an occasion to the flesh. Here we go. But by love serve one another. Go over to Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians chapter 4. And notice there at verse 2. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 2. With all lowliness and meekness, with all longsuffering, forbearing one another, notice, in love. We're going to love is a value system, by the way. Love is a way of perceiving and thinking. Let love be without dissimulation. And we'll see a verse here. In fact, let's go over there. 1 Thessalonians chapter 3. 1 Thessalonians chapter 3. And 1 Thessalonians chapter 3. And again, we read this a little bit earlier, but 1 Thessalonians chapter 3, verse 12. The Lord and the Lord make you increase and abound in love. How does the Lord, quote, make you increase and abound? Number one, do you notice this isn't natural? This demonstrates loving one another isn't necessarily natural. In fact, go over there to chapter 4, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, and notice there at verse 9. Chapter 4, verse 9. But as touching brotherly love, ye need not that I write unto you, for ye yourselves, here we go, are taught of God to love one another. We have to learn how to do this. It doesn't just come spontaneously. You know, we use the word love really in such a flippant way. I mean, I'm guilty of it. I love football. I love vacation. I love my job. I love spaghetti. Now, let me ask you this. my love for spaghetti, is that the same as being taught by God to love one another? Here's my point. There is a realm of divine love. There is a level of the most premier love, godly love, is something that is unnatural. It's not in our DNA. So here at verse 9, ye yourselves are taught of God. Compare that with chapter 3 and verse 12 again. And the Lord make you to increase and abound in love one to another. So how does God, quote, make you increase and abound in love? He's teaching us. As we learn the doctrine, as we learn about what love is Paul talking about. What love are we a student of? We need to be students of love. So when we talk about love, again, we've taken that word and it's been so desensitized, you know. I don't want to love you the way I love spaghetti. And by the way, I don't really love spaghetti, okay? I love pizza. Well, that's not the type of love. That isn't divine love. That's not, quote, agape love. That's not the highest form of love. My love for pizza. That comes because of who I am. I want to learn, what is God teaching me about love? And let Him make me from the inside out to increase and abound. By the way, the product of grace is love. And the more we're enamored by grace, the more we increase in that high level of godly love towards one another. He'll make you. I love that. The Lord make you increase and abound. That's what grace ultimately does, right? Let's talk about this high level of love. I mentioned, some time ago, I wish I wrote the date down because I don't know what year this was. Whatever year this was. If you were to go out to Amazon.com, you ever heard of Amazon.com? My goodness, the trucks are out in force right now. According to Amazon.com, there were, I don't know what year this was, I failed to write the year down, 32,000 books with the word love in the title. There were 145,000 books dealing with the subject of love. Everybody wants to know about love. Everybody wants to be loved. That is one reason why there are 145, and I'm sure it's probably even double the number now. Why are there 150,000 books on the subject of love? Because people want to be loved. There were, at the time, 11,000 CDs with the word love in the title. Google, at this time, they stated that 120 million websites in the world uses the word love in their web address. 120 million websites with the word. So the world is infatuated with love, right? Make love not what? Love makes the world go. So, I mean, the world talks a great deal about love. Was it the Beatles? All you need is love, right? Love, 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 love. We need to learn what godly love is. What exactly is this highest level of love? Let's go to John chapter 15, okay? John chapter 15. And interesting, we have a love formula here in John chapter 15. John chapter 15. And, we don't need to go to the dictionary. We don't need to go to Amazon.com. We don't need to listen to a CD to learn about divine love. The Bible, God's going to teach us. And quite frankly, we don't need to go to a dictionary to learn about the definition of love. We can go to the cross. We can go to Calvary. There's the definition of love, okay? So when we're examining, how do I love you? How do we love one another? This is high-level stuff. John chapter 15, verse 9. John 15, verse 9. As the Father hath loved me, so have I loved you. Drop down to verse 12. This is my commandment, that ye love one another as I have loved you. Do you see the formula? As the Father hath loved me, so have I, Christ, loved you, and you love one another as I love. Listen, God is the standard. God the Father, and let's go over there to 1 John chapter 4. 1 John chapter 4. John, in 1 John chapter 4, you know what he says about love? He says God is love. So God is love. He loves his Son. His Son loves God's people. And the Lord says, you love one another the same way I've loved you. So you have this recipe, if you will. It begins with the Father. There's a level of love that God the Father possesses that now is channeled through the person of his Son, Jesus Christ, who in turn, the Son becomes the personification of the love of the Father. He now in turn channels the love of the Father towards his people, and he now exhorts his people, you love one another with the same love that my Father has towards me, that I now have towards you. So it's possible for God's people to love in the highest level of God-like love. It's taught. God's going to make you do it. It doesn't come naturally. Okay? 1 John chapter 4, verse 7. 1 John chapter 4, verse 7. Beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God. So we're not going to get it from the world. We're not going to get it from self-help books, okay? We're not going to find it from our friends. We may not even find it from our family. We're not going to find it from other, you know, so on and on. The verse is pretty clear, for love is of God, and everyone that loveth is born of God and knoweth God. Verse 8, he that loveth not knoweth not God, for God is what? Love. How do you define God? I mean, different ways. When the verse says God is, you know, Richard said it a million times, God is love, but is love God? Of course not. We understand that, right? But how do you define, how does God define himself? According to verse 8, God is love. He's the standard. He's the definition of love. So we go to him. And that's why the Lord Jesus says, yeah, he loved me. Jesus Christ is the very object of the love of the Father. And in turn, God's people becomes the very object of the Lord Jesus Christ's love, and in turn, love ye one. You and I need to be one another's object of the highest level love, because that's what defines us. It should define us. It defines God. God is love. It's a person. Verse 9, in this was manifested the love of God toward us, because that God sent his only begotten Son in the world that we might live through him. Herein is love, not that we loved him, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins. Beloved, if God so loved us, we ought also to love one another. There's the standard right there. There is something about the capacity that God possesses that defines him, that has something to do with sending his Son. And as the verse says, he sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins. Beloved, if God so loved us, we ought also to love one another. The cross is going to define what this high level of godly love is. And we'll flesh some of that out. Number one, the love of the Father had as its object the Lord Jesus Christ. Okay? And we know, if you go real quick, Matthew chapter 3, you're familiar with these passages. If we go to Matthew chapter 3, and we're not going to go to every one of them, right at the onset, at the start of the Lord's ministry to the nation of Israel, we understand that. Matthew chapter 3, look there at verse 17. And lo, a voice from heaven saying, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased." We've commented on that before. You see the prefix "be loved." And it's just absolutely fascinating that that word "be loved" was first used in 1520, in the 1520s. That word was coined by the translators of the English Bible. You can look that up. Go to etymologyonline.org. The word "beloved" was first used in the language of the Bible to convey something about this high level of love. The prefix, of course, intensifies. You know, the word "beseech," for example. You know, Paul, for example, Romans 12, he says, "I beseech you, therefore." The word "beseech," you know what it means to seech? It means to seek. When Paul says, I intensify the verb. I want you to greatly, intensely seek something. Beseech. Now, you know, modern translations, they'll say, "I beg you." Okay? Beg. The word "beseech" conveys something. I want you to look for something intensely. That's the word "beseech." We can appreciate the English language just a little bit better here, okay? But the idea here at verse 17, "Lo, a voice from heaven saying, 'This is my beloved.'" And there were a couple of, number of times, three times. The Father identifies the object of His love. "My Son." In fact, go to John chapter 17. If we go to John chapter 17, the first thing we note is this. "As the Father hath loved me, and the Father intensely, greatly loves His Son." The Father adored His Son. So God is love. He is defined as love. And He has an object of that love. His Son, Jesus Christ, is the Son of love. Let that hit home for just a second here. The Lord Jesus is the Son of God's love, John chapter 17. And I trust you know what we're going to be getting at here. You know that when you trust Jesus Christ as your Savior, we in turn become sons of love. The same measure of adoration and love. You see, we're not just something to God the Father. We're everything to God the Father, because we're in the one who is everything to God the Father. I know we often live our lives, you know, with the sense of defeat, the sense of inferiority, the sense of failure, the sense of inadequacy, the sense of this, that, and all that. And you know, I mentioned earlier, why are there 145,000 books that deal with the topic of love? Because many, they don't feel they're loved. When it's as though God's Word, certainly Paul's epistles, screams, "I love you. The Father loves us. He adores us. We're the sons of love. We're the children of love." If we don't understand that, how in the world am I ever going to love David? And how is David ever going to, how are we going to love one another? If we fail to first recognize and value the fact that God loves us that intensely. In John chapter 17, what does the Lord say at verse 24? "Father, I will that they also, whom thou hast given me, be with me where I am, that they may behold my glory which thou hast given me. For thou lovest me before the foundation of the world." Jesus Christ becomes the personification of God's love. And He's the personification of God's love to the world. Jesus Christ becomes a vessel. And remember, that's who we are now. We're, as members of the body of Christ, we are vessels. We are supposed to be containers of love. We're the object of God's love. We, Ephesians 4, we're accepted where? In the beloved. Romans chapter 1, verse 7, Paul talks, he writes to the Romans, dearly beloved. Colossians chapter 3, we are holy and beloved. Over and over again. When we view that love that our Father has in our his heart towards each and every one of us, now we're learning something. That's the starting point. So Jesus Christ now becomes the channel of that love. You're familiar with John. Everybody can quote John 3:16, right? God so loved the world that he what? Gave. See, the personification of God's love is in a person. You and I, we're equal members of this body of Christ. We're supposed to be the personification as the sons of love towards one another. We're go over to Galatians chapter 2. This one of my favorite. Galatians chapter 2. In Galatians chapter 2, verse 20, I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me. Now, this is what we're going to focus on. And what did he do? Gave himself for me. The Lord Jesus Christ, he literally joined in our humanity, right? Jesus unioned himself with the human race. He joined himself with the human race. And by doing that, obviously the Lord Jesus, he identifies with our despair, our brokenness, our helplessness, our anguish, our suffering, so on and so on and so forth. He literally joins himself with humanity. Now, what are we learning about being members of the body? Are we not joined together as one body? We are in union one with another. God the Father's love is manifested, personified in the person of his Son, who is now a container of that love. And the Father says, I'm going to give you my Son. The Son, Jesus Christ, gives himself by, again, identifying with humanity. We, as the beloved, we're the channel, we're the container where this love of God is now to be expressed, and we're in living, loving union with each other. We're joined to each other. We can do what Jesus Christ did. And of course, when we talk about love, again, you know, the word has been so cheapened, but when we look at the issue of love, we find, let's go to Ephesians chapter 4. Go to Ephesians chapter 5, I'm sorry, Ephesians chapter 5. When we talk about love, it's a value system, and that's certainly something we want to recognize. Love is a value system, and you can measure love based upon what it costs the giver in relationship to the worthiness of the recipient. Just think about that for a second. Isn't it easy to love someone who loves you back? Of course. So when you think about, well, when God chose to love us, and I think about Ephesians chapter 2. Well, in fact, let's talk about value. Love is a value system. Love sees worth. God, by the way, he sees worth when no one else saw any worth. For example, Ephesians chapter 2, verse 1, and you hath he quickened who were dead in trespasses and sins. What do you do with a corpse? Is there value in a corpse? Is there value in death? You know what it means? Death. We were dead in trespasses and sins. We were worthless corpses on the spiritual landscape. There's no value from a dead man. What does a dead man produce? What does a dead man contribute? Nothing. Verse 2. Where in time past ye walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience, among whom also we all had our conversation in times past, in the lust of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature the children of wrath, even as others. You've heard this, we're dead, darkened, dominated. There was no eternal worth in a dead man. Verse 4, but God, who is rich in mercy for his great love, wherewith he loved us. Great love. This is, again, the highest level, the supreme premier level of love. Finds value in the valueless. You know, how do you put worth? I used this illustration so long ago. When we lived in Pennsylvania, you could buy an acre of land for $800. And shortly after, my sister and her husband, before he died, they lived in Naperville. And back in the, when did we come back? The late 90s. I don't know, I'm going to my sister's house in Naperville, and there was this monster sign, land for sale. You know how much they were selling land for in Naperville in the late 90s, mid-late 90s? $1 million for an acre of dirt. Now think about this. Chemically speaking, an acre of dirt in Pennsylvania and an acre of dirt in Naperville, I think it's pretty much the same dirt. Okay, they say Illinois soil is far richer. Okay, all right, we'll place a little more value on Illinois soil. Okay, but the composition of dirt, the chemical makeup of dirt, why would an acre of Naperville dirt be $1 million and an acre of Pennsylvania dirt be $800? You know, value, who determines value? The buyer does. Who determines value when it comes to love? God is love. He's the standard of love, and he's going to demonstrate what love is. He looks at this landscape of worthless, dead, useless corpses. We're literally the rubbish of the universe. I mean, consigned to Satan. Dead. And God says, but I love you. God chose to ascribe worth to the very objects that were valueless. So nobody else saw value. By the way, the adversary didn't see value. That was the master genius of Almighty God. You know, you think about how Satan, in his own wise conceit, he didn't even see. He viewed the Gentiles. He viewed us as worthless, dead in trespasses and sins. And in his wildest imagination, how can God ever use these abandoned, alienated Gentiles? How can God ever use a lot of people dead, darkened, dominated by sin, and used as pawns of rebellion? And yet God says, I do value them. And you know how he valued us. Verse 4 again, but God, who is rich in mercy for his great love wherewith he loved us, even when we were dead in sins, hath quickened us together with Christ. By grace ye are saved. Love is defined by the level of value that the giver is willing to give towards the worthiness of the recipient. And when we find, we're in Ephesians, go to Ephesians chapter 5, over and over again, for the remaining couple of minutes here, Ephesians chapter 5, verse 1, be ye therefore followers of God as what? Dear children. Dear. Never let that word dear sink. We're dear children. We're not stepchildren. We're not naturalized citizens. I'm a naturalized citizen. I think there's another naturalized. I got a piece of paper that says I'm a citizen of the United States of America. Okay, I wasn't born in America. I could never be president. Who would want to be president? Too late anyway. But you understand, when you are adopted by God, we're not naturalized citizens of heaven. We, you know, Titus tells us we've been regenerated. We are viewed and treated as God's natural born children. Think about that for a second. Remember, we were dead in trespasses and sins. We were excluded. And what God now accepts us in the beloved. And he now calls us dear children, the object of his affection and adoration. Again, we're not just something. We're everything to God, just like his son Jesus Christ is everything to him. So don't view yourself as a second-class citizen. I'm not just a child of God. I'm dear. I'm a dear child. We don't always think that way, do we? I don't always feel that way. I understand that. But as dear children, verse 2, and walk in love, as Christ also hath loved us, and hath given himself for an offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet-smelling savor. What the Lord Jesus Christ did is he literally gifted himself. When you study the issue of offerings and sweet-smelling savor, the sacrifices, okay? Go back to Leviticus. You find out there are these different types of offerings and sacrifices. You have the free will offerings. The sweet-smelling sacrifice was a free will offering. It wasn't mandated. You know what Jesus did when he gave himself, by the way, as an offering and a sacrifice? Well, wait a minute. Aren't they the same thing? No. What would an offering be? What happens when in the Old Testament somebody committed transgression or sin? There was a prescribed offering that was required. Now, God had a very sophisticated system, maybe a bullock, maybe a goat, maybe a ram, maybe a dove, whatever. Anyway, there were mandated offerings for various types of sins, you know, meat offerings, cereal offerings, blah, 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 blah. Jesus was an offering. He was the propitiation. He was God's offering, the Lamb of God, only not for any of his, for our sins, right? But Jesus was also a sacrifice, a sweet-smelling savor. He gave himself as a gift, a free will offering, voluntarily gifting himself to God on our behalf. Now, think about that. Love one another. You can view others with we can have a God-like value system. You mean everything to God. Do you mean everything to me? I mean everything to God. Do I mean everything to you? Do you view me? Do I view you with that same system of value that, you know what, in the eyes of God, maybe you are worthless, undeserving of it, but guess what love does? Love graciously, voluntarily gives. As that verse says, walk in love as Christ also loved us and hath given himself. And drop down. We're in chapter 5. Look there at verse 25. Husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also love the church and gave himself for it. Galatians chapter 1, Galatians chapter 2, he gave. The personification of love is giving. The Father gave his Son, the Son gave himself, and we now give ourselves to those that maybe appear to be unworthy, valueless, and frankly, undeserving. But that's, you see, God make you, and there's the doctrine. There's that type of love, all right? So we're out of time. Love one another. But we're not just flippantly talking about emotional-based love that's driven by sentimentality. Wait, this is a value system. It's defined by God, as God. God is love. So to love entails the willingness to gift ourselves one for another, not to get anything. That's not love, by the way. Love that seeks to gain something isn't love. Godly love is a love that seeks to give. Father, we do thank you for your grace. We do thank you for your love. And as we continually learn the principles that are given so that we can properly maintain the relationship between one another as members of the body of Christ. May we continually learn, and may we allow the truth to impact the way we see how you're working, see who you are, see who we are all one of another. We do thank you for your word, and as always, may it work effectually as we believe it to be the truth, and it's in Christ's name.